Hi friends, welcome back to my channel. So today let's see about the plant cell wall basics. Okay, so this is the plant cell wall structure, and in this plant cell wall we will be seeing about the home background biosynthesis, galactoronans, rhamnogalactouronans 1, rhamnogalactouronan 2, hemicellulose, walls and development, and walls and pathogens, lower plant walls, internet resources, contact information. Okay, overview. Plant cell wall research at the CCRC. CCRC means Complex Carbohydrate Research Center, is carried out by 6 independently funded groups. These groups study diverse topics that include the primary structure and three-dimensional conformations of wall components, the interactions of wall components, and the biosynthesis of wall components. So these are the group study diverse topics where we are going through these topics. Okay, primary structure, three-dimensional conformation of wall components, interactions of wall components, and biosynthesis of wall components. In addition, we are studying the role of the cell wall as a source of biological active molecules, as a barrier to plant pathogens, and as a source of biofuels. So all these things we are going to see in this class. Okay, what is a primary cell wall? Growing plant cells are surrounded by a polysaccharide rich primary wall. So as we know that plant cell walls are growing, right, which is surrounded by a polysaccharide rich primary wall. This wall is a part of the apoplast, which itself is largely self-contiguous and contains everything that is located between the plasma membrane and the cuticle. The primary wall and the middle lamella account for most of the apoplast in growing tissue. So as we know, the primary wall and a middle lamella accounts most for the apoplast, which is growing for the tissue. The symplast is another unique feature of plant tissues. This self-contiguous phase exists because tube-like structures known as plasmodesmata connect the cytoplasm of different cells. Plants differ in shape and size. These differences result from the different morphologies of the various cells that make up the vegetative and reproductive organs of the plant body. Changes in tissues and organ morphology that occur during plant growth and development results from controlled cell divisions and growth together with modification and structural reorganization of the wall, and the synthesis and the insertion of new material into the existing wall. So this is about the plant primary cell wall. Okay, some of the functions of the primary cell wall: structural and mechanical support, maintenance and determine cell shape, resist internal turgor pressure of the cell, control rate and direction of the growth, ultimate responsible for plant architecture and form, regulate diffusion of material through the apoplast, carbohydrate storage, walls of seeds may be metabolized, protect against pathogens, dehydration, and other environmental factors. Sources of biological active signaling molecules, cell-to-cell interactions. So primary walls are the major textural components of the plant-derived foods. The ripening of the fruits and vegetables is associated with changes in wall structure and composition. Plant-derived beverages often contain significant amount of wall polysaccharides. Some wall polysaccharides bind heavily metals, stimulate the immune system, or regulate serum cholesterol. Wall polysaccharides are used commercially as gums, gels, and stabilizers. Thus, cell wall structure and organization is of interest to the plant scientists, the food processing industry, and the nutritionists. Next, primary wall composition and architecture. Primary wall isolated from higher plant tissues, and cells are composed predominantly of polysaccharides together with lesser amount of structural glycoproteins, hydroxyproline-rich extensions, phenolic esters, ferulic and cormoric acids, ionically and covalently bounded minerals, example calcium and boron, and enzymes. In addition, walls contain proteins expansions that are believed to have a role in regulating wall expansion. Lignin, a macromolecule composed of highly cross-linked phenolic molecules, is a major component of secondary walls. The major polysaccharides in the primary walls are cellulose, a polysaccharide composed of 1,4 linked beta D glucose residues. Hemicellulose, branched polysaccharides that are structurally homologous to cellulose because they have a backbone composed of 1,4 linked beta D hexosyl residues. The predominant hemicellulose in many primary walls is xyloglucan. Other hemicelluloses found in primary and secondary walls including glucuronoxylane, arabinoxylane, glucomannan and galactomannan. Pectin, a family of complex polysaccharides that all contain 1,4 linked alpha D galacturonic acid. To date, three classes of pectic polysaccharides have been characterized: homogalactouranans, rhamnogalactouranans and substituted galactouranans. The organization and the interactions of wall components is not known with certainty, and there is still considerable debate about how wall organization is modified to allow cells to expand and grow. Several models have been proposed to account for the mechanical properties of the wall. Now we will be seeing about the covalently cross-linked model. Peter Albert Schrem and colleagues in 1973 proposed that the wall matrix polymers xyloglucan, pectin and galactoprotein are covalently linked to one another. The binding of xyloglucan to cellulose microfibrils results in a non-covalently cross-linked cellulose hemicellulose network that gives the wall tensile strength. This model has been questioned because of the lack of evidence for the existence of covalent linkage between xyloglucan, pectin and glycoprotein. Key structure shown in the cell wall models. So this is the cellulose microfibril pectin matrix structural protein. H-bonded xyloglucan plus covalent linker. H-bond xyloglucan tether. H-bonded xyloglucan loosely bonded xyloglucan. So these are the key structures where the cell wall models are dependent upon. Okay, this is the stratified layer model where the xyloglucan molecules are hydrogen bonded to and cross-linked cellulose microfibril. The cellulose xyloglucan laminae are separated by strata of pectin polysaccharides. The tethered model, xyloglucan molecules are hydrogen bonded to and cross-linking cellulose microfibrils. The cellulose xyloglucan network is enmeshed in a non-covalent cross-linked pectin network. So this is the tethered model. Okay. Next is the diffuse layer model. So this is the diffuse layer model where the xyloglucan molecules are hydrogen bonded to the surface of cellulose microfibrils but do not directly cross-link them. So they are not cross-linked, okay, directly not cross-linked, okay. The tightly bound xyloglucan is surrounded by a layer of less tightly bound polysaccharides. The cellulose and the xyloglucans are embedded in a pectin matrices. So the cellulose and xyloglucans are embedded in the pectin matrices, okay. So as we know that this is the stratified layer model. Much research is still required to provide a complete description of the primary wall at the molecular level. Moreover, there is increasing evidence that primary walls are dynamic structures whose composition and architecture changes during plant growth and development. So as we see in this case, the primary cell wall is changing its dynamic structures, okay, while plant is growing and developing, okay. Secondary cell walls. Plants form two types of cell walls that differ in functions in composition. Primary walls surround growing and dividing plant cells. These walls provide mechanical strength but must also expand to allow the cell to grow and divide. The much thicker and stronger secondary wall. See figure on right, which accounts for most of the carbohydrates in biomass, is deposited once the cell has ceased to grow. The secondary walls of xylem fibers, touchets, and chelaerates are further strengthened by the incorporation of lignin. The evolution of conducting tissues with rigid secondary cell walls was a critical adaptive event in the history of land plants, as it facilitated the transport of water and nutrients and allowed extensive upright growth. Secondary walls also have a major impact on human life, as they are a major component of wood and are sources of nutrition for livestock. In addition, secondary walls may help to reduce our dependence on petroleum, as they account for the bulk of renewable biomass that can be converted to fuel. Nevertheless, numerous technical challenges must be overcome to enable the efficient utilization of secondary walls for energy production and for agriculture. So this is the structure of the secondary cell wall. Okay. So secondary cell wall S1, S2, S3. So this is the closest of the secondary cell wall, where the stages of the cell walls are shown. So this is the primary wall and middle lamella. Primary and secondary walls contain cellulose, hemicellulose and pectin, albeit in different proportions. Approximately equal amount of pectin and hemicellulose are present in dicot primary walls, whereas hemicellulose is more abundant in grasses, etc. switchgrass. The secondary walls of woody tissues and grasses are composed predominantly of cellulose, lignin and hemicellulose. Xylene, glucuronoxylene, arabinoxylene, glucomannan. So the cellulose fibrils are embedded in a network of hemicellulose and lignin. Cross-linking of this network is believed to result in the elimination of water from the wall and the formation of hydrophobic composite that limits accessibility of hydrolytic enzymes and is a major contributor to the structural characteristics of secondary walls. Xylene, which accounts for up to 30% of the mass of the secondary walls in wood and grasses, contributes to the recalcitrance of these walls to enzymic degradation. A high xylene content in wood pulp increases the economic environmental costs of bleaching in paper manufacturing, thus reducing the xylene content of secondary walls and altering xylene structure, molecular weight, ease of extractability and susceptibility to enzymatic fragmentation are key targets for the genetic improvement of plants. However, progress in these areas is limited by our incomplete understanding of the mechanisms of xylene biosynthesis. Xylenes have a backbone of 1,4 linked beta-D xylosyl residues with a short alpha-D glucosyl uronic acid GLCA, 4-O methyl alpha-D glucosyl uronic acid MEGLCA, alpha-L arabinosyl O-acetyl furylyl or coumarouyl side chains. So this is the hemicellulosic polysaccharide present in secondary cell walls. So glucuronoxylene. So this is the structure of the glucuronoxylene. The glucosyl sequence at the reducing end of the dicot glucuronoxylene. So this is the structure of the dicot glucuronoxylene. Furylorylated arabinoxylene structure. This is the structure of the furylorylated arabinoxylene. Glucomannan. This is the structure of the glucomannan. Xylene synthesis requires the coordinated action of numerous enzymes, including glucosyl transferases, GTs, that elongate the backbone and add side chain residues. None of these GTs have been purified and biochemically characterized, although several candidate genes have been identified. Little is known about the factors that regulate secondary wall polysaccharides biosynthesis and the mechanism that control the assembly of these polysaccharides into a functional wall. Moreover, the mechanisms required to initiate and terminate xylene synthesis and to control the chain length of the xylene are as yet unidentified. Now let's see the techniques used at the Complex Carbohydrate Research Center to study walls. Okay, we are interested in several aspects of primary and secondary walls, including primary structure of the wall polysaccharides, conformation and interactions of the wall polysaccharides, biosynthesis of wall polysaccharides, molecular and genetic mechanism involved in wall formation, developmentally associated changes in wall structure, the role of the wall in plant pathogen interactions. We use the following plants and suspension cultured plants cells as source of cell walls. Plants cultured cells. Arabidopsis, Arabidopsis. So in plants, Arabidopsis plant is there. Cultured cells also, Arabidopsis is done. Tomato, tomato is done. Tobacco, sycamore, lamina, rice, ferns, soya beans, horsetails, grapefruit, lycopods, psychometrilla, moss, mosses, anthocerosis, hornwort, live rots, chara, green algae, hornworts, coleochaete, green algae. Primary structures of wall polysaccharides. Pectin polysaccharides, RG1, RG2 and oligogalactouridines are released by treating walls with endopolygalactouridinase. High molecular weight pectin polysaccharides are solubilized with aqueous buffers and chelators such as CDTA. Xyloglucan oligosaccharides are solubilized by treating walls with endoglucanase. High molecular weight hemicellulose, xylene, glucuronoxylenes, arabinoxylenes, glucomannans and xyloglucans are solubilized by treating walls with 1 and 4M KOH. Solubilized polysaccharides are then purified by size exclusion and anion exchange chromatographies. The primary sequence of a polysaccharide is known when the following have been determined. The quantitative glycosyl residue composition, arabinose, fructose, galactose, galactose A, glucose, xylose, 2:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1:1: sequence of the glycosyl residues. The sequence of the glycosyl residues. This is the sequence of the glycosyl residues. Okay. The conformation and interactions of wall polysaccharides. These structures involve extensive use of 2D NMR spectroscopy and computer-aided molecular modeling techniques. We are also growing plants in a 13 carbon enriched environment to generate isotopically labeled polysaccharides that can be characterized using C13 NMR spectroscopy on xyloglucan. So about xyloglucan we will be seeing in the next class. Okay. Biosynthesis of pectin polysaccharides. We have developed methods for the purification and assay of enzymes involved in pectin biosynthesis and for enzymes involved in the formation of various nucleotide sugars. In addition, we are using molecular techniques to clone and express numerous enzymes involved in cell wall biosynthesis. So in further classes, we will be seeing about the xyloglucan and biosynthesis. Okay. Okay, friends. Thank you. Thanks for watching. If you like my video, please kindly like, share and subscribe it with your friends also. Thank you. Thank you so much for watching. I will be meeting you in the next class. Bye-bye.